The origin of Jeremio traces back up almost like a transhuman's sheep trail up into the foothills and up into the mountains of the Maiella to Taranta Paligna. My great-grandmother was a 15, 16-year-old kitchen girl in the grand home of the padrone of the town who owned the woolen mills. And Taranta Paligna was a, in the turn of the century and up through the First World War and so forth, Taranta Paligna was manufactured and spun. This is a design that is absolutely specific to Taranta Paligna. This is their design, and it's peasanty, it's pagany, it's their own brand, if you will. A woman named Cam Price did this in 1955, as you can see. Cam was my mother's dearest, dearest friend. She lived on the south shore of Long Island. We lived on the north shore of Long Island. Mm-hmm. So they would drive back and forth across the island for cocktails and dinner and whatever, just hanging out all day. We would spend a whole weekend there very often. They had a big sprawling turn of the century place in Bayshore, Long Island. And her husband was Georgie Price. Cam really captured something here. Of all the renderings and even photographs I've ever seen of my father, this just captures a part of his nature with uncanny insight. I think she saw through his bravado. She saw through his facade, if you will, and she really, really captured the a bit of insecurity. This is the sign that was this is from the Strong's Neck House, Strong's Neck in Setauket on Long Island. This sign was on the masonry front of the garage, a beautiful two-story brick garage, kind of colonial style, that that he built with his own hands around 1952. And this sign is also very connected to Setauket because it was done by a local artist named Pat Windrow. The war was still on when they built that house. And he didn't build the masonry garage till about 52 or 3. I remember as a tiny, tiny toddler, he and his brothers working on pouring the floor of the inside the garage. But so it was an interesting place because the house itself is a framed colonial cedar shake. Classic, charming, small but elegant. And then he out of his own genius of architecture and design created this Cape colonial style garage, but all in masonry, right next to the all-frame wood house, you see. Now, the core of that house was a wonderful large chimney unit that went up through the center of the house, and he and his brothers did all that, and they did all the masonry foundation of the block walls of the foundation. They did all whatever masonry that the house we lived in needed, they, of course, provided. By the time he was 17, he was 17, 18, he was the best. He also, at the age of 15, was the youngest journeyman apprentice union bricklayer, the youngest, if you will, union bricklayer in the United States. He never said that. He never said, I was the best bricklayer, basically, in the world. Well, you know, how many bricklayers begin at the age of 12 with the weight of the world on their shoulders? Very few. Maybe back in the 1800s and so forth, those kind of things happened. But by 1923, 24, 25, the, you know, child labor laws were coming in, truants officers at school and this and that kind of thing was very rare. all through his youngest years of 12, 13, 14, 15, he was dodging truants officers and having the paisans in the neighborhood close a ring around him and lie to the truants officers and so forth. Where's Peter? Where's Peter? No. He cursed it, and he loved it. He said, I can't understand a man that doesn't build anything with his hands. This came out, I didn't look in the front there. Maybe 1950-ish. That's 11 years after the original. It was a reprint, you know. It was a cheap reprint by Lion. Is that published by Lion? Yes. I love it. It's cubist. It's impressionistic. It's slightly abstract, and it's also chiseled. And it's got such drama and so dynamic, you know. It's a wonderful cover. I'm not sure what kind of plates where they were. They might have been wood carvings. They're stark. They convey the pathos and the struggle of inside the tenement very, very beautifully.
And you are fighting like women. Look, levers are going ahead.
Story behind why it was not shot in Hollywood, because Edward Dimitrik was, as we know today, the father of noir. Murder My Sweet and Crossfire. He was one of the, at that time, he was under investigation by HUAC, and he was one of the Hollywood 10. He was one of the names as one of the Hollywood 10. And so he was self-exiled out of Hollywood, went to London with basically all the other blacklisted exiles. They went to London to work, and he managed to hobble together a significant independent production outside the studio system at that time. Full loaded, not only Leia Padovani, who couldn't speak a word of English. She did a beautiful, magnificent job as my grandmother, just absolutely magnificent. And Sam Wanamaker. Throwing himself around the set a lot, lunging around the set. He was certainly very sincere and believable. And looking back on it now, it worked somehow. You know, it was a believable movie, with plenty of pathos. Once the deal was made, the writer is very often pretty much cut out of, we don't want you, We really don't, unless it's agreed that the writer is going to work on the screenplay. But that wasn't the case here. Dimitrik wanted to bring in another blacklisted Hollywood personality, a talent, Ben Barsman, who had written Back to Bataan with John Wayne for Dimitrik. Big Hollywood screenwriter. So he brought Ben Barsman in to write the screenplay. And Sam Wanamaker, who was already over there, and they brought Leia Padovani from Italy, and then a fabulous supporting cast. I've never seen a movie with a supporting cast like this. It was first released in England, where it was shot, and under the title "Give Us This Day." Then when it was distributed in America, they changed the title again to "Salt to the Devil." Now they could not use the original title "Christ on Concrete" because they couldn't use the word Christ in a title back then.
What is your personal memory of your father? What is, when you close your eyes, how do you see him? What do you see?
Well, you know, I didn't expect that question, and what jumped into my mind was an impression that was totally impressionistic. I was about 3 years old, three and a half, and very, 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 very kind of audacious. And it was early in the morning. And we had the Strong Snack House had a very small little kitchen. Kitchens were simple and small back in those days. And and I'm standing in the center of the kitchen. It's a very small area. My father's at the stove pouring boiled coffee into his saucer to gulp down to cool it quickly so he could rush out. Uncle John is in the kitchen too. Uncle Jose is in the kitchen. The kitchen is, towering above me are these guys. I'm looking up at them. I'm down at the level of their concrete, cement, dusted boots, and their work pants, and the wonderful smell of lime and Portland cement, and Chesterfields, you know, cigarettes. And I am just ecstatic. I am so excited.
Thank you.